Welcome to Scenario D,
the podcast that takes you behind the magic by giving you the facts and a whole lot of feels.
I'm Lish.
And I'm Kirbs.
And this week we're visiting the jazz-soaked streets of New York City with the saxophone-drenched world of Oliver and Company. So grab yourself a spot at the piano.
And get ready to hear some sweet, sweet piano licks.
As Billy Joel, Bette Midler, and an orange tabby cat tell us a story that takes place once upon a time in New York City. Okay, Kirbs. Oliver and Company time. I am going to just be straight up honest right out of the gate. I watched this movie and it was Black Friday, so I got distracted with Black Friday shopping online. And the movie ended and I was like, oh, I didn't absorb any of that. I'm not sure what just happened. I played it again. Mm-hmm. I still don't think that I really got any of it. I'm not going to lie. This kind of all happened in a bit of a fever dream. And I don't like it at all. Do you
like this movie? It's like, let's just make a blanket statement. I don't like it. And that's really what it is. I don't dislike it. I actually, so I too was doing other things while watching it. I was not Black Friday shopping. I was making custom baby blocks for my best friend's new baby.
They turned out really good.
Thank you. Oh my goodness. Yeah. Like if anyone in our audience would like custom made baby blocks by me, we could make that an Etsy business. We can take that conversation offline. I really think that they turned out really well. Ironically, no Oliver and character companies. Oh my gosh. Oliver and Company characters. Clearly we are not obsessed with this movie in any way, shape or form, because I can barely talk about it while making sense. But there were, I was making these blocks, watching the movie. I didn't watch it with rapt attention. I do enjoy parts of it. That's why it can't be at the bottom of the list. Georgette is a star. Georgette is iconic. Her song is incredible. Arguably the best song in the whole movie. I don't like her as a character. Like, she's actually horrible. Yeah. And we'll talk about that later. But I enjoy is too strong a word, but dislike is too strong a word as well. It's just a film. Like, it's just a movie that came out in 1988.
It's there.
We have to visit it because it exists. It's kind of like Rescuers Down Under, and these are right after other.
Here's what I'm wondering, because I watched this movie growing up. If I remember correctly, my younger sister Jazz really liked it, and so it was kind of on a bit. So this one I knew that I didn't like. I don't remember anything about the Rescuers
about the Down Under.
So, like, I'm, like, right now I'm thinking that this one should be in the bottom, but I have to see how bad Rescuers Down Under is. Like, at least I'm thinking, like, you know, Bernard and Bianca are cute. Like, it's probably going to be a little bit better than this one.
I'm pretty sure I had a crush on the Australian mouse. I mean, a mouse in a hat in a Disney film, apparently I'm into it because I'm Team Bernard always. I love Basil, the Great Mouse Detective, and now, is his name Jack, I think, from Rescuers Down Under.
No idea.
I don't know. It doesn't really matter. We're going to get there soon enough and we'll probably both be upset about it. And that's just how it's going to go. That's how this goes most of the time. I'm not surprised that Chaz liked this movie, though.
It's The Lion King after that.
True. True. It's The Lion King after
Onward and Upward.
Well, and really after that, there's only one more. It's Zootopia. Like, we're really close to the end here. You've really suffered well to get to this point. I would say you suffered with quite a bit of grace. I would say that I've kind of thrived in this season. I've really enjoyed a lot of what we've watched.
What?
I've
no, had but real like, no right problems. Up until, are you kidding? The first like six movies, Kirbs, you were like, I don't like this. I don't like this. I was bored. I took out the garbage.
You're right. And came back. No, you're right. And you're right. It's because the past like five, I've been a big fan. We started slow for me.
Yeah.
And better for you. And then we kind of traded place like ships in the night. And so I'm just remembering, you know what? this is coming with my word of the year, which was embrace. I'm just trying to embrace the moment we're in, which is one where I'm not mad. So I'm thinking there about it as like, I'm not mad, but like, I was mad. You're right. I wasn't happy with quite a few of those right off the bat. Although I did like Dumbo. It set the season off for me in a really good tone.
I like Dumbo.
The tone of this movie, not so hot, but I would like to say I understand why Chaz liked this movie because it's, you know, an abandoned, forgotten character. Oliver is literally set adrift in a cardboard box after being abandoned by both humans and cats alike. And doesn't she have that Quasimodo complex, you know?
Anyone who needs caring for Chaz, the need to save Quasimodo. Yeah. Yes. No, I think you're probably right. We may be onto something there. There's a therapy session for Chaz without her being present. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Chaz, call me. We'll talk you through it. It's going to be fine. It's going to be fine, kiddo.
So let's talk about like what's going on around the time period that Oliver and Company came out. So we talked in the Great Mouse Detective episode about this transition to the new Disney leadership. We've got Michael Eisner, Frank Wells, Jeffrey Katzenberg all at the helm in different capacities overseeing the Disney Animation Studio. So the Black Cauldron and the Great Mouse Detective were in some form of production when they joined. Oliver and Company was the first one that was greenlit from scratch from this new executive team. Animated features have been like years apart throughout the 70s and 80s. Like some of them that we'd be like, oh, there was like 6 years since the last like animated feature came out. And that's just kind of the pace that they were moving in, both because nobody wanted to spend the time or money to make more than that because they weren't really producing at the box office, etc. So when these new guys joined, they really wanted to get back to what Walt actually was trying to do in the early 1940s, which is have an animated feature come out every single year. And there's been various points of Disney history when they've been trying to execute that. That was like one of Bob Iger's things a few years ago when he was running the company. It was like, you know, when he took over Pixar, he's like, okay, we're up in the pace. Like, you guys got to do like one a year and like we're, you know, expanding. And this was also something they were trying to do in the late 80s as well. So after they started production on this film, they were also moving to The Rescuers Down Under and The Little Mermaid was also going into production. So by the time that this film came out, there's already movement on both Aladdin and Beauty and the Beast. So I'm just trying to, I guess, set the stage that while this is not technically part of the Renaissance, like I think we can both agree that for us, like the start is when Little Mermaid comes out. But I think it is worth noting that the Renaissance energy is at the studio while this movie is being made. Like, Howard is in the building. Like, Alan is in the building. Things are happening. Like, though that moment has started, at least partway through the filming, the production of this.
Well, because part of that was Jelly Ketchup was like, a movie a year. Like, that's the way to do it, right? So that leadership between him and Frank Wells and Mikey E., they're already thinking much more as kind of a film studio with a capital F and a capital S, right? That's not animation. So they're looking at it at like other studios are putting out a movie a year. We should be doing the same thing. Otherwise, what are we doing? And then the animators, being a new team of animators, are probably like, all right, like I guess like we can set that tone. We can kind of like match that. Whereas the old guard, which we were kind of, you know, shedding throughout the 70s and the Xerox era, were the people who had known Walt, worked with him intimately, kind of cared more about the capital C craft of animation. And now Disney Animation is being led by people who are like, this is a studio.
But like this was something that like Walt wanted as well. Like this was always Walt's dream was to be able to be like, you know, like this one's coming out, but these three are already in some phase of production and we're just like keeping the wheels spinning. It just means you have a bigger team. Like it doesn't necessarily mean that you can't, like we saw that in the Renaissance. It was like movie every year and they were all amazing for about 5 years and then it kind of started to go downhill. So it's not that that's necessarily impossible. It just means that you have to be investing in the team and the studio, like with financial energy, with marketing energy, like with a lot of different elements that have to come from the top in order to like actually make that happen successfully.
Yes.
And they were starting to do that, which is awesome.
And with people who are staying in their lanes, because as we talked about with our like Walt's the worst episode this season, it's like Walt wanted to be in charge of every single aspect of his film studio, which also slowed down. Ironically, he was his own saboteur because he wanted to be the person deciding everything at every level, which is like, all right, great. So you're not actually empowering the people you have to make this dream of yours happen. And he had a brother who was like, I'm the money guy and what you want is not practical or feasible based on what we've seen come back like in dividends from that way of thinking. So unfortunately, Walt, we're gonna pump the brakes. And then he was like, oh, by the way, I'm dead. So I mean, not to put too fine a point on it,
but
you know, sorry about it. Really.
Sorry.
Yeah, so like I hear what you're saying. The vision for this was already there. The foundation from a company level was there, but no one had actually picked up all those pieces and gone, oh, it's here, let's actually do it now. And Jelly Ketchup was like, we're doing it.
Yeah, and I think that they, and I, like, it's interesting what you said about people staying in their lanes, because I do think that something that this, that is something this regime kind of did pretty well with, like, having Jeffrey Katzenberg overseeing, like, the film division, and they had Peter Snyder specifically for the animation division, and then they had a lot of really strong different directors that all kind of just, like, worked on their own movie, and then just like, you know, the artists kind of moved and shuffled around where needed, but it's just like they really are starting to establish that strong creative direction for each thing as it's needed. And so like that's kind of what this new regime was bringing that actually made the Renaissance possible for sure.
And I think there is like there's sacrifice with doing things that way, like even at my ad agency that I work at, we have certain accounts where like it's one creative director with a couple associate like assistant or associate creative directors, and then us creatives kind of at the lower end of the hierarchy, we're the ones that move around, but the leaders stay the same. And that sometimes, I mean, from the client perspective, it's amazing. From a business perspective, it's perfect because you're the person who knows that business intimately. You can make decisions quickly and effectively, but there's also that kind of catch 22 where then you as a creative leader are kind of stuck in that role. Like you don't actually have the wherewithal to be able to like move around. And of course that's what Walt wanted to avoid for himself, because selfishly he's like, I want to do it all because I came up with this. But
Never had, like, he didn't really have directors, I think was like his main issue, where it's like, you know, if he had had Wooly on this film and then let's get like Frank and Ollie fully directing this other movie, and then it's just like stuff like that would have just made, would have really opened the floodgates to what would have been possible back in those early days. But it was just kind of like a hodgepodge of everybody working on everything and not organized and streamlined in an effective way, which they're trying, they're starting to figure out now in the late 1980s. So that's a huge positive. We talked, if you can go way, way back to when we talked about Little Mermaid in season one, this is where we talked about the gong show, if you remember this. This is where everyone at Disney Animation Studio could pitch new ideas for features. So anyone who worked in the building could come to the gong show, bring their new story idea, and then they would consider it for you know, a feature animation project. So story artist Pete Young came and he pitched Oliver Twist with dogs. And Katzenberg was very excited by the project. He approved it right away to go into development. Both Eisner and Katzenberg were originally from New York City, so I think they loved the idea of the film being set there. They're very good at animals at this point. Like, they've had a lot of success with the past few animal movies, but haven't done, like, a all-dog story lately. So it's, like, the whole thing of that felt fresh and really appealed to everybody. So the original story treatment was much darker. It started with Sykes to Doberman's murdering Oliver's parents as like the start of the film, and then made it more of a revenge tale for him. So the original directors were George Scribner and Richard Rich. So Richard Rich actually left the studio about 6 months into production, leaving George Scribner as the only director. So it was really hard to find information on what exactly went on and happened here. There were some accounts that say Peter Snyder, who was the head of the animation studio at the time, fired him. And other reports say that he left to form his own company, and his own company is what brought us the Swan Princess and the, like, 200 sequels that are, I think, still coming out to this day, if I'm not mistaken. So if I had to guess, personally, I would say that he was fired. He was a director on Fox and the Hound and The Black Cauldron, and both of them really had a lot of, like, behind-the-scenes tension, and not that I can say, like, oh, this was, like, all his fault, but it could be possible that there was, like, some recurring drama or tensions or disagreements or something, and he just, like, didn't play nice with others, and that was kind of the reason. Don't totally know, but that's kind of what I would surmise.
I mean, not everyone knows how to play well with others. Some people, you know, just actually can't, even if they're really effective at the job they're asked to do. It doesn't mean that you can do it in an environment where you're not the only person responsible for the end product. I mean,
arguably, like, Walt didn't really play well with others. He just happened to be, like, in a
don't get me started.
That was fine. So, yeah. Richard Rich was the youngest director in Disney history. So even though his time there was short, he will always have that to his name. So let's talk about Scribner. Scribner, is that how you say it? Am I saying it
properly? I assumed it was Scribner.
Scribner?
Yeah, because there's no H.
Okay, preemptive apology for that. Scribner. So let's talk about him. He had worked as an animator on The Black Cauldron, and he also directed the featurette The Prince and the Pauper. That's like one of the little, like, Mickey.
Oh, those are cuties. Ones. Yeah.
Yeah, they're very cute.
Have you ever seen that?
I don't know if I've seen that one specifically, but maybe I should. Probably on
Disney. I remember watching it and thinking it was great. I don't, like, I was so young. Yeah? That's really the only impression I had, but I really enjoyed it. I don't know if it's because it was Mickey. I don't know if it's because of the story. It could be a combination of things, but I really enjoyed it. I feel like there's one part where someone goes to jail, and I found that really scary, but I was also a super fearful child, so that could be it.
Jail is scary. He was also credited as the original director of The Lion King. So we will have more on that in a few weeks. Get into that kind of story.
Oh,
but
my goodness. I think you're making that up. So just talk about The Lion King.
No.
I don't believe you. I don't believe you.
I would not. No, you might. So he had a very, like, short career at Disney. So, like, all that to kind of say that, like, this movie is kind of his thing. Like, this is the thing that he did at Disney Animation Studios. He directed it. It was, like, you know, he wasn't the one that originally pitched it, but it really, a lot of that came from him. It's his calling card. So most likely there was some story issues between the two directors as kind of things went in a different direction when Rich left. The story became much less dark. Oliver became a cat. Fagin became a human. And, like, it kind of began to take shape as we know it. So that's why I kind of think, like, Richie Rich and Scribner were, like, having some, like, different opinions on how that was going, and then, you know, obviously this guy won. What do you think? Like, do you want the darker version? Like, do you think that would have made things better? Like, to me, I feel like it might have gone, like, too Black Cauldron-y if it was in that way. Like, the pops of song and, like, the use of color was, like, really the only good parts of this movie for me. So that wasn't there.
I think it's interesting to hear that there was a darker version, because when I was watching this, I was like, this is a pretty, like, dark
movie. It's a scary villain. It is,
like, Sykes literally, Fagin comes to Sykes' office, opens the door, and we hear Sykes talking about putting someone in cement shoes, which is essentially a murder plot that Fagin is just, like, walking into. And that's just fine, apparently. That's casual. And that final chase scene, that is so long and it's so dramatic. It's the stakes are so high. We've got animals in danger. We have a child in danger. We have arguably another vulnerable population, which is Fagin, who is someone who is below the poverty line, and, like, he's in jeopardy. There's, like, it's a very dark movie with, to your point, pops of color and some Billy Joel songs.
Yeah.
Which is, like, a weird combination. But this idea of directors not agreeing on story, this is a tale as old as time at Disney. We've seen this how many times? Like, Emperor's New Groove had a lot of story changes and story disagreements. I know a lot of other, even just animal films we've talked about in this season. Can I think of any off the top of my head? No, but I know there have been a bunch because, where the directors are not.
There was like a, it basically went like Walt making all the decisions. Mm-hmm. And then anyone who didn't agree was just like off the project. And we saw that many times, not necessarily with the director, but with like a story lead and like basically all the main story guys like Bill Pete and like all of them from the early days left on like bad terms because of like disagreements with Walt and all that fun stuff. Then we kind of went to a Wooly Ritherman era where again it was kind of the same thing. I feel like he wasn't quite Walt, but as soon as the young people came up and started to like challenge him, then like it got weird, and then Wooly left, and then now we're in this, like, new, like, weird space where they're trying to establish, like, who these, like, important sets of directors and creative leadership are, and just, like, figuring out, like, who's gonna make the cut. I feel like from here on, though, there's a little bit less of that. I mean, like, you're gonna have it here and there, but I feel like they developed a few, like, core individual directors or like a set like, you know, Ron and John that's just like worked really successfully for the most part. So
yeah, and again, it comes from people staying in their lanes. It comes from acknowledging like you're the best at this, so you should be the person who makes the call. It should not be because someone was friends with Walt and they were put into that position, because some of them were effective in those roles for a time, but like animation being such an expensive, arduous art form, particularly at the time where there was less CGI happening, right? Like less use from technology. Sure. You gotta make sure that every dollar you're spending on these projects is going to good use. And sometimes that means putting the right people in the right role so that the decisions that are being made from a leadership per film level downwards are actually going to be impactful, that they're actually going to accomplish what you're trying to accomplish instead of throwing stuff at the wall. The time for that has passed. You cannot do that anymore. You just can't.
We have no more time for throwing it at the wall. You're absolutely right.
No.
So for this movie, for the actual production of it, they ended up using the same technique that was used on Lady and the Tramp back with our Claude Coates, if you remember correctly.
Oh, I do.
To have the scene play out from the dog or cat's perspective, instead of using, like, they basically took the cameras and set them up from that perspective and captured that with photos so that they could translate the layout to actually match correctly with what that point of view would look like. So in Lady and the Tramp, they did this with, they built the models and all of that. Instead of doing that for Oliver and Company, they actually just went to New York City and took those photos, setting up a tripod with what a cat or dog's POV would be. So like 18 inches off the ground. So that was used as templates for the layouts that they could then go and draw over and create something that's a little bit more realistic in terms of the scope for that. So that was pretty cool. Yep. One of the biggest challenges throughout the film was the animation of Jenny. Now, I don't know. I don't know how you felt watching it, but how bad she looked was a real standout for me. Was that noticeable at all for you?
No, because I grew up watching a VHS that had that "You and Me Together Will Be" song on it, and I always liked it because I always saw myself as a Jenny. You know, I really wanted like a pet that I could skip through the park with, and who I could play the piano with.
Yeah,
I mean, but so I actually never noticed that. What I noticed more is how Oliver's proportions compared to people and other objects was so wild from shot to shot. He is the size of a small toddler at the beginning, but then also a tiny cat in the next shot. Like, it was all over the place.
It's definitely, their two scale sides, one is coin. Definitely a little bit inconsistent for sure. But for Jenny, they were still working with a very green crop of animators. And if you look at the last few films, not a lot of human animation. So this was a little bit new for a lot of the team, but they really felt like it was important to have at least one human in this film and like to try to like focus on that animation, because looking at what's coming up, like they knew They're doing The Little Mermaid. Like, we're going to have to be able to, like, do a better job at people and, mm-hmm. like, you know, looking at Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, all those other things that are in some form of pre-production. It kind of seemed like this is the way that we're going. So, like, we do need to get a little bit better at this. So they were, like, kind of used this as a little bit of, like, a learning tool. But I think if you look at, you know, Penny's animation and then you look at Ariel's, it's just, like, night and day. Like, it's, you know, we got a lot better in just, like, the year.
A very short time. But wait. Girls. You said Penny. Jenny or Penny? Okay.
Both.
I mean, arguably Penny as well. Like your statement rings true.
Yes.
From Penny to Ariel is also dramatically different.
Yes.
But I think it's so funny that it stood out so much to you, because I did not, let's put it this way. She looked as bad as everything else in this movie to me. It did not leap out to me as exceptionally worse.
The animals looked better, quite a bit better. Just, like, how they were animated. Just everything looked smoother and just the line work better. And, but I also felt like, to your point, like, a lot of the backgrounds and stuff were also not great. So it's she was, like, the only problem, but, like, it was noticeable for me.
So you've already mentioned that this was, like, another dog movie, and I never thought about how many dog movies there are in the Disney animated canon until we started doing this season, and I'm like, am I just not a dogs person? Like, has my dog sitting experience from the summer that just completely traumatized me, and now all these dog movies I don't like pointed out to me that maybe I shouldn't have a dog, even though I've always wanted one?
There's not that... What is there? There's 101 Dalmatians, Lady and the Tramp...
maybe that's it, but it just feels like so many more. I don't know. I clearly just don't.
But you're don't like the only person in the world that, like, vehemently hates 101 Dalmatians. Like,
that
it's
movie sucks.
Such a
loved movie,
and it's so good. Anyway, that's not what we're talking about.
We're not
now.
Talking about that. I merely meant this as, like, a nice segue into what I'm about to talk about, but I've already made it a grumpy segue. So that's on me entirely. Because dogs are a common trope, we kind of feel like from Lady and the Tramp, we saw a lot of those themes come through in the Aristocats with 101 Dalmatians. Mm-hmm. It's really tempting to make another movie that's 100% about dogs, feel like these two films that were pretty iconic and that were, as you pointed out, quite beloved by people up until this point. So the filmmakers for this film knew, like, we need to treat this differently. And of course, their response to that, how do we make this feel different, is just to give the dogs stereotyped personalities again. Because that's worked really well in the past, giving cultural stereotypes to dogs. Why don't we just do that again?
That was not the thing to take from Lady and the Tramp.
No.
Like, the camera angles, like, yes. Great job.
Yes.
This?
Yeah, camera angles.
No.
Neato.
Yeah.
Giving Tramp, Peggy, Jacques and Pongo cameos in the opening, like, Why Should I Worry musical sequence. Yeah, we love that. We love to see that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they're all showing up.
Do it.
Fun fact. Kirbs is fun fact. There is also a signed photo of Tramp in Georgette's room and one of Radigan. Radigan sent her a photo of himself as an admirer, which I think is hilarious because Radigan is so fabulous.
We're just entering, like, the cheeky age, you know.
We are.
They're
we,
like,
honestly,
we can just, like, stick little thingies in there.
Yeah.
You know?
I think that this is a nice kind of early precursor to what Pixar did really well with films like Toy Story, where they're adding jokes and references and almost, like, visual gags for the adults in the room that you're not going to get if you're 5, you're not going to get if you're 12. But when you rewatch it as a 20-something, you're going, I didn't even notice that. That didn't even occur to me. So,
well, didn't, like, John Lasseter work on some of these? Maybe.
Probably.
Yeah.
Probably. And that makes perfect sense. You know, like, he had a huge impact on making all of these stories and universes feel connected later on when he was in charge of so many of those creative decisions at Disney. So it would not surprise me if he was on some of these and made some of those suggestions. But going back to Oliver and Company for a second. And by for a second, I mean for many more minutes, because that is what we're talking about today. The filmmakers have admitted since this movie came out, you know, maybe we didn't do such a good job of giving unique personalities to our dogs. Like, Francis is borderline. The British dog, it's borderline. He's kind of pretentious, which if you're British, you might take offense to that. But he is also super intelligent. The real issue is Tito. We can't, like this Chihuahua who clearly is meant to be a Mexican dog, who was apparently inspired by Scribner's Puerto Rican, like, upbringing, allegedly.
Okay.
However, he hotwires cars and is, like, hypersexual with Georgette. Like, those are his defining features. It's like, those are, not how you should be representing that piece of diversity within New York City. Like, right. You can't tell me that Cheech Martin, the voice actor, thought that this was, like, a great way to be represented as a Hispanic person in the States. Yeah. Like, again, people weren't as upset about this as they have been with some of the others. It's more like a, why did you do that? Like, why? And Cheech Martin is a Hispanic man who was popular in films and TV around this time. So at least we have the right ethnicity with the right character. It's just not, like, why? Why did they feel the need to do this? Like you said, kind of keep the good parts about making the film from a production standpoint, from a dog's point of view, that's all fine and dandy. But, like, why did we have to?
It's also just lazy storytelling to, like, rest on, like, an accent basically being, like, the defining characteristic of the character. Yeah. And it's just, it's lazy.
I'm sure that Jelly Ketchup was looking at it going, people will recognize Cheech Martin's voice and that will give them points. And maybe it did at the time. It just feels, again, like we're hitting our heads against the wall and rolling our eyes at, like, this is the best you got. That's so ridiculous. The other piece of this that a lot of people look at now from a story perspective is, like, calling us an adaptation is kind of not really something you can do, because it's one of
get
the
Eric
loosest...
on the line.
Yeah, yeah. Dialing in from Elmira. Like,
our adaptation,
it's just one of the
expert.
Loosest. Yeah, it's one of the loosest adaptations they've ever done. Like, as you mentioned, this is, of course, Oliver Twist, but with many, many, many twists. And it's, like, you know,
too
the fact
twists.
That it's entirely modern. It's nothing but animals. Like, it's 1980s New York City. It's just not
it's the,
it.
Like, it's the, I don't know anything about Oliver Twist, clearly. Like, it's the story the same? Because, like, I still feel like something's an adaptation if you're taking really the same story and modernizing it, or, like, switching up. Like, making it animals, like, that still counts to me if the story arc and characters are still true to the original.
There's bits and pieces that you can still say are true. Like, Oliver in the original story, and, like, no one come for me on this. Oliver Twist was one of those English units that I was just bored to death. Like, not even just to tears. Like, I felt like I died in every English class. Like, I actually felt I was not receiving information. The signals were not coming from within the house. I don't remember very much about it at all, except for how scary the movie was. However, Oliver in the original story, he's an orphan who is kind of taken under Fagin's wing, and Fagin leads this group of pickpockets. So that is accurate. That is kind of true. And I believe in the original story, Sykes is also someone who Fagin owes a debt to. So again, that is also similar. But, like, the fact that it's dogs made people kind of like, all right, like, you're calling this Oliver Twist because the cat's name is Oliver, but, like, really, what are we doing here?
Yeah.
And, I mean,
pretty loose.
There, as you mentioned, a lot of issues with story development early on. We really had to kind of fire some people, find our feet, move along, go with something. Another Kirbs is fun fact is that similar to The Rescuers, this was meant to be originally a sequel of an earlier Disney film, in this case, The Rescuers. Jenny's name is Jenny because it's one letter off from Penny. And originally, Penny was going... Rumored. This is a rumor.
Okay.
I feel I should say this is a rumor, but it's rumored that Penny was supposed to be the girl who, like, adopted Oliver, kind of, like, paid it forward. Like, oh my gosh, you abandoned cat, let me help you. But timeline-wise, it doesn't make any sense because Rescuers ends in the year 1978 on Friday the 13th in the month of December or November or something like that when she gets adopted.
Right.
This movie takes place in the late 80s, which means she would have been, like, almost 20, which isn't as compelling a story. And then if you try to make it that she's the same age, we're now just, like, playing with space-time continuums that Disney's not really interested in doing. But there was a similar thought to, like, when they originally were like, let's have Cruella be the villain in The Rescuers. Like, let's have Jenny who, Penny. Oh my goodness, this name is so
It's easy. Really it's difficult. You know, it's gotten both of us now. So.
It's gotten both of us now, and I thought we were intelligent women. Apparently not. I think they were looking at it going, well, people were rooting for Penny by the end of The Rescuers. Like, we want to see Penny be a person who can continue to be, like, loving and caring and blah, 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 blah. But they were like, honestly, this just doesn't make that much sense. So let's,
and you know, they would have already been working on, like, a different Rescuers sequel. Like, are we just, like, the Rescuers company now? Like, that's it? Well, that's all we do?
Remember,
like,
remember that The Rescuers did pretty well. People yeah, liked true. The Rescuers. Yeah. So it was, in this kind of dark ages of Disney, it was one of the brighter spots. Yeah, so for if sure. they're looking to build on momentum, it is a film to kind of hitch your wagon to.
Fair.
But, I mean, they ultimately clearly steered away from that. Rumored or not, they didn't go that way. But still kept playing with some of these dark themes. We already
instead,
talked
they
about...
just basically kept the same name and changed one letter. They were like, yeah, we don't want to change really... the whole name in the script. We're just going to, like, you know, put some white out and
well, we already wrote it.
Letter.
I don't want to.
Yeah.
We were barely scraping by. We need to make every piece of yeah. paper count. You know, we can't just be print. We didn't yeah. have laser printers at the time. How you Come think on. They're reading these scripts? Yeah. How you think they're printing those out? You worked at Staples. You know how expensive oh, an yeah. inkjet cartridge is.
Not cheap. Not cheap.
Very, very expensive.
How they
you'd
get
be better
you.
Off just buying a new printer. Yeah, you'd be better yes. off just getting those half-filled cartridges and calling it a day.
Yep.
Regardless, we've already alluded to the fact that this movie has some really dark themes. We're talking about chasing children, abducting children, animals being abandoned, and also, like, why? Sykes's dogs, okay? Mm-hmm. First of all, beautiful dogs. Like,
they are
love.
Gorgeous.
Big fan. Yeah. Why are they sexual predators? Like, why are they harassing Rita, the female dog in Fagin's crew? Like, and why are they clearly coded as black? Like, why are we doing this? Why is this still a thing we're doing in the 80s at yeah. Disney? What are we doing? All the dogs of color are, like, sexually deviant in some way or suggestive of that behavior. I don't
it
understand
just
how
sucks
we don't
because
get
it feels like we made so much progress with Fox and the Hound and just like the way that they were like telling that very important story and then
oh
to just
goodness.
Go and like cheapen
it's
it all
so
with
lazy.
This
it's
like it's
so
just like,
lazy bleh. It's lazy and it's gross and I mean it just infuriates me. It makes me so mad because yeah. this could so easily be avoided, especially because Sykes on his own, he didn't even need those dogs to talk. Honestly, it almost would have been better if his dogs didn't talk because Sykes is terrifying. And when they were designing this character, there was a conversation around like, maybe we shouldn't show him. Like, you know, in Inspector Gadget, the claw, right? Like you never see him. You just see his claw hand and like petting his cat. There was talk about it being that kind of way. Do you actually know what I'm talking about with Inspector Gadget or did you just nod?
Oh, no, I worked on Inspector
oh, okay.
Gadget. Like, I have seen,
oh, fantastic.
You don't
oh,
even
there you
know
go.
How much Inspector Gadget I've seen.
Okay.
Blow your mind.
I just yeah. want to make sure, because you didn't really react. Not that it's super interesting, I guess. This is implying that I think this is so fascinating. It's a fact. It's not a fun yeah. fact. It's just a fact. But anyway,
no
back on track
this
here.
One.
This movie is such a hot mess that you and I, like I said, fever dream while recording this. We're going to listen to this back and go, what were we talking about? Like,
yeah, it's going to be a tough one to edit.
Mm-hmm.
I can already tell. Yeah.
But worth it for the listeners.
Yeah.
Worth it for the listeners.
For you guys, we'll do it.
Yeah. So originally, Scribner, the director, was like, I don't want the audience to see Sykes. I think it'd be scarier if it's just his limo window cracking open and hearing that voice. But Glenn Keane, who was the animator for Sykes, was like, no, 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 no. We need to see him to really get that strength and power that he's exerting over all these other characters.
Glenn just wanted to animate him.
I mean, like that was my initial reaction. The filmmakers ultimately ended up agreeing with him because after doing like a test scene, they're like, okay, yeah, like Glenn clearly had a vision for what this character should look like and how he could take up space on screen. And I do think I agree with him. And it's not just because I'm a Glenn stan.
Yeah.
I do think it just makes Sykes even scarier because similar to the conversation we had around Frollo or Gaston, it's like these are people that exist. Giving them
he's
a face.
Super scary.
Giving them space makes a lot more sense. Mm-hmm. And really, this Sykes scariness, this, you know, stereotyping of people of color, love that for us. This is just really feeding into some of those themes we see in Lady and the Tramp and the Aristocats as well that bled into this movie. It's almost like when Disney tries to make a movie that's dog-centric or animal-centric in some way. We just have to talk about the same things, that being like class. Class is really the thing that came up a lot in Oliver Twist as an original story, but in this telling as well. And, you know, it's kind of Oliver as this young ingenue who kind of has this father-son relationship with Dodger, but then ultimately abandons him for the comfier lifestyle. And there's such a fascinating discussion around this movie and these themes, which we don't have enough time to cover. But if you're interested, like me, in some of these cultural context pieces, highly recommend looking into it. Or if you just want a more detailed discussion around this type of thing, our friend Daniel at Income Paint Pod, he talks really nicely about this part of the film and how that kind of all comes together. But that the crux of this story was Oliver and Jenny both being orphans, right? Oliver is literally abandoned and Jenny's parents suck. Did you pick up on that watching this? How awful her parents are?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Their daughter's turning 10 or something and they're like, we're not coming home. We're on a business trip. Are you kidding me? I don't even know if they knew she was kidnapped or if they did. It was literally a phone call of them going, glad she's home. See you in 3 weeks. Like, what is that?
Yeah. No, that was...
I was upset.
That was not cool. At least she has a nice butler, I guess, but...
Oh my goodness, we love him. Yeah. We love him. But this kind of abandonment is really what makes Jenny's affection or love for Oliver grow in the first place. If you're cynical, you're looking at this like, oh, she's trying to fill a void because her parents aren't around. And I mean, absent parents is a common Disney trope. We see that a lot. And this also leads people to believe that, you know, Oliver really is a symbol of that next generation, you know, that next generation that is kind of literally a child the whole time, but then he moves from being a waif to a protector to kind of this beacon of what could happen and how your life can transform if you're given the right opportunities and all of this. So he's like, I don't know, considering he's just a small orange cat that doesn't get a name until halfway in, he seems to do a lot of heavy lifting for people. They really seem to think that Oliver is doing something. But I could care less about Oliver. What I cared most about in this movie is the music, because as you know, I'm a big sucker for Disney soundtracks, and I have always thought that this one slaps. Like,
really? Like the soundtrack as a whole, not just the like main songs?
I think it's so good. This like retro saxophone heavy score. Some people describe it as zesty, which I'm a big fan of. Right. It's like super kitschy and campy when you listen to it in 2023, but honestly, it's just, it's so good. Why should I worry? Amazing. Like,
that is a good song. Dodger that is playing on my Disney playlist.
It's so good. And it's like Joel and I only recognized certain places in New York City when we went with our parents because of that song. They love me at the Chelsea. They adore me at the Ritz. It's literally thought of by some people as like a tourist guidebook. In the first line, they mention Central Park, Delancey Street, the Bowery, and St. Mark's Cathedral, like all in two lines. So it's great. I've already said that I think Georgette's song, Perfect Isn't Easy, which was co-written by Barry Manilow. Bless. Love that. Mm, yeah. We have a song performed by Ruth Pointer of the Pointer Sisters. That's the song that Rita sings called Streets of Gold. And then that first opening song, the Once Upon a Time in New York City, that was sung by Huey Lewis. And was Howard Ashman's first co-writing credit for Disney. So Howard blessed this soundtrack.
That's a fun fact if I ever heard one.
Kirbs is fun fact. Like I am a big fan of this soundtrack. And I mean, you can't have this movie or this soundtrack without Billy Joel, without Bette Midler. Like these two were really the heart and soul of what made this movie effective in the music department. And this was really, you know, coming from Jelly Ketchup going like, we need another layer of appeal if we want this movie to do well. Like we can rake him over the coals as much as we want, but Katzenberg did know how to market movies and he accurately made the assumption that, like, you know, these two artists are great. They're fantastic. They have mass appeal and they've won awards because people want to hear them performing. So let's give them an opportunity within our studio to perform. So Scribner from the very beginning was like, it needs to be Billy Joel for Dodger because, as you've already mentioned, you know, he grew up in New York City, obsessed with New York City. Was it him? No, it was Jelly Ketchup and Eisner, right? We're New York City boys.
I don't know if Scribner is also from New York City, but Katzenberg and Eisner were both from different parts, so they were really into that whole idea.
Great. Yeah. We love that. So let's just, you know what, I'm going to lump Scribner in there too. It's just he's a big fan of New York City. Big fan.
Who isn't, right?
I mean, that's fair. I don't know. Actually, am I a big fan? I don't know if I'm a big fan. But regardless, he wanted Billy Joel because Billy Joel had been a hit maker for 20 years. His sound as the piano man was synonymous with New York City. And he also felt that Billy Joel was like Dodger's street smart Manhattan attitude. So he pitched the idea to Billy Joel, who actually auditioned via telephone due to his busy tour schedule. He was in the middle of like a cross-country tour, but he's like, I'm interested in this. I'd like to do it. And then they obviously lent on him to help set the tone for the music overall, but he was not the primary songwriter. Contrary to popular belief, there were a lot of songwriters who worked on this. We've already alluded to a few of them, and this was unusual for Disney at the time. A lot of the movies we've talked about in this season in particular, it's kind of one person doing that and maybe outsourcing a few pieces for the score, maybe lyrics here and there, but in terms of songwriting, it's often like...
But isn't that the case for like Disney films like as a whole? Like not just the early ones, but even like through the Renaissance and now... That's generally they do, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I would say so. So it's just in general, blanket statement. It's unusual for Disney for it to kind of be this diverse of a songwriting team. But in interviews with Scribner since then, he's like, we were making this up as we went. So like from song to song, we were figuring it out, trying to find where it fit in the story beats, trying to make a story that made sense and was captivating and could make use of these artists while it was happening. And, I mean, this is part of the reason that Bette Midler was cast as well, because she was known for, I mean, a huge career by then in film and TV, but also on Broadway. And Broadway is such an iconic New York idea of that course. They're like, we need someone to kind of capture that spirit. And what I found really interesting is that there was this old Hollywood choreographer named Busby Berkeley. Fun name, who became known for these bird's eye view shots that showcase dancers arranged in geometric shapes. So you know in Georgette's song, Perfect Isn't Easy, the birds kind of fly around her head in a circle. Mm-hmm. This is an homage to him because he was known on Broadway and in old Hollywood as being this, you know, kind of, I don't even know the word, just a stalwart pillar of that kind of community. So having Bette Midler's voice with that kind of visual cue is once again strengthening the tie this movie has to some of this arts and culture scene that New York is so known for. And then they kind of rounded this out with Dom DeLuise playing Sykes. He had a very distinctive voice, obviously. It's very scary. But what is best about this, in my opinion, is that he was poached from Don Bluth, who, as we know from our last episode, had abandoned Disney and tried to start a competing studio. And Bluth had cast Dom DeLuise in The Secret of Nim and An American Tale. So his voice was starting to become known, like a Phil Harris type of quality with Dom Bluth. And then Disney said, hello, come be with us. And he said, okay. So, yeah, Dom Bluth really kind of getting the short end of the stick. But
But he deserves to be poached because he did all the poaching first. So I'm not even
100%. I'm not saying that, you know, he shouldn't have been poached. I'm glad we poached him because I think Sykes is a really strong character in this movie. I think that he is a fish, like appropriately scary for the type of stuff he's doing. So it made sense. And for all of these reasons, okay, we've talked about Billy Joel, Bette Midler, trying to find those sounds of New York. This is one of the first musically focused films that, like, it's like the soundtrack is driving it. And this is why some people, I know I said this with Great Mouse Detective, but a lot of people in the 80s trying to make the claim that any of these films are the start of the Renaissance. Some people are saying because this is the first kind of Broadway-inspired-esque film, that this is the unofficial, the soft launch of the Renaissance. Some people say that because this is Howard's first appearance in the credits, that this is the soft launch, because of course he and Alan were largely responsible for the Little Mermaid being what it is. So we're starting to get that Renaissance flavor.
I don't disagree. Like the Renaissance vibe has started, but this just isn't, and like soft launch is a good way to say it, because this just doesn't flow with all the awesomeness that came out starting with The Little Mermaid, but it's just like the energy is in the building. Like it's starting to seep through. It's just like not all the way there yet.
And I think a lot of that comes from how they were experimenting with the technology piece of this as well, because they are pushing the limits from a soundtrack perspective, from a visual language perspective, even though like it wasn't good. Setting it in a contemporary place kind of was them trying to establish themselves of something. And then, of course, all the stuff they did with CGI to kind of start that experimentation that would ultimately mm-hmm. help define the Renaissance was a big part of that too.
Because I get that argument, because like we talked about in The Great Mouse Detective, they were starting to use the cat's computer system, and that worked so successfully. Like, that was like the biggest thing to kind of come out of that movie. Huge. So we're now at the point where it's like every film is just starting to like grow on that just a little mm-hmm. bit. We're just like inching closer to having a full CG animated film. So for Oliver and Company, they actually had over 11 minutes of computer assisted imagery. They're still doing characters entirely 2D, but using computer animation for certain background elements and stuff like that. So there's like an interesting quote by Scribner that's basically like, computers can't do emotions and characters. They can't make Oliver move better, but they do the inanimate objects, freeing the animators to spend more time on the flesh and blood creations. And it's interesting, like, to read that quote now, because it's like, computers are now so good. Like, look at any Pixar movie. They're so good at emotions and characters and just how far we've come. But if we go back to the late 80s, that's just like a huge, huge weakness and not something they're able to do. So they ended up using it for a lot of New York City, and I mean, in some respects, that is another, like you kind of talked about, like New York is a character here. Like, they did treat it as like,
yeah,
just like the, like, it's kind of like the heart of the movie is the actual location. Yeah. So they wanted to make sure that like they captured the like hustle and the movement and the traffic and like all of that parts of New York City that CG really enabled them to do within the time and budget that they have. So elements like Fagin's trike, Sykes' limo, the piano that he's on that like gets like risen, different cityscapes, the Brooklyn Bridge, these are all elements that were comprised of CG animation. And this really allowed the animators to spend their time focusing on the characters instead of having to worry about all these different effects and elements and stuff like that to be able to create them with the CAPS computer system went a long way for this film.
I think so, like, for sure. I mean, we've seen the results of them learning how to use the technology and harness it into all those Renaissance films. And I think, like, New York City is where this movie starts, and it's kind of where it ends as well. I think that, like a lot of the other Disney films, particularly in the 80s, where, you know, you have someone like Jeffrey Katzenberg at the helm who's going, we need to make this a moment. Like, we need to make the release of these movies feel like a big event, because they are. We're putting all these resources into it. We are crafting these to be money-making machines, quite honestly. And in order to make it a money-making machine, people need to know what the value is inside of it. And New York is what people were coming to see this movie for. I think that, you know, being set in a contemporary time is now making this film very dated for us, because in those opening scenes in particular, you're seeing all these old, old, old cars. You're seeing old logos for things like Pepsi. You're seeing like a lot of stuff that just isn't there anymore. And like that final shot of Staten Island, for example, like that landscape has changed, right? Since this movie came out in 1988, New York City has gone through a lot of stuff on both like grand scale, but also smaller scale, where it doesn't look that way anymore. But putting all their eggs into that basket, I think, was smart for trying to get this movie in front of an audience that was eager to see a new and exciting story from Disney, but also something familiar, because Disney at its core is nostalgic. People don't want a movie about New York City to not look and feel like New York City. It should, if that's what they're promising. So, you know, they worked with architects to make sure that everything was accurate to what New York City looked like at the time. And as a result, they also tried to emphasize some of those lines over top of the backgrounds and landscapes. Like, they intentionally were like, let's use some of that Xerox stuff just to make this skyline really pop. And then they had these kind of dreamy creamsicle washed pastel color palettes. Like, they tried to make it romantic for everybody, and they came into the theater piping hot on November 18th, 1988, which was the same day as Don Bluth's masterpiece, The Land Before Time.
No way. The same day? Dirty. Like, Bluth did that on purpose, right?
Or Disney did it on purpose. They both did it on purpose. They both were like, we need to compete with each other. We need to prove who's dominant. And The Land Before Time did better opening weekend than Oliver and Company.
It's a better movie. So
it is. The Land Before Time made $7.4 million in their opening weekend. And Oliver and Company was only four. So, like, kind of sad. But eventually, Oliver and Company did surpass The Land Before Time domestically, but not by a landslide. Like, people loved The Land Before Time. And I think some of these reasons that we've already discussed as why people might have liked Oliver and Company is ultimately why they didn't, right? It's like, the story isn't that interesting. The characters are kind of weak. The music's great, but it's kind of feels, like, stuck in place. Like, there's not, for all its drama, for all of its ingenuity, for all of that, for Billy Joel, for Bette Midler, it still is just kind of, like, lacking magic. There's no, like,
it's got sparkle. Like, bits and pieces going on. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you've got, like, the Glenn Keane animation, but then you've also got this other character who's not very well animated. You've got, like, some, like, not solid direction in terms of, like, what we're going for with color. Yep. Like, we're a bit all over the place there. And, like, yeah, like, the music, you've got hits, you've got, like, things that are just okay, but does it all really flow together? Like, it's just, like, the pieces are there. We just haven't, like, been able to bring it together into something.
Yes, exactly. Yet. The sum of its parts was kind of meh. And really, like, the biggest takeaway that I can see from this film coming out was really that they were solidifying that Don Bluth and Disney were competing in the 80s. Mm, that's really, like, what it was. And Don Bluth at this point was winning. Like, he was coming out ahead in opening weekends with the numbers. There was a bit more energy and hype around his stories. He was making more of those fantastical tales, you know, like from Secret of Nim to An American Tale. There was just something a bit more exploratory and adventurous about that. But of course, we know what happened in 1989 when The Little Mermaid came out and earned $84.4 million in its first weekend, which was three times more than All Dogs Go to Heaven, which was Don Bluth's contribution around the same time. Ugh. Horrible. Yeah. Horrible. And again with the dogs, like, why is Bluth obsessed with animals? Like, very little of his films, very few of them seem to be people. I mean,
they are easier to animate, so I think.
And yet he does it poorly. You know what I mean? Like, is it really easier? Don Bluth's really.
it is, and just imagine how bad his people would be.
Oh, well, I mean, we saw, right? Yeah. He was Anastasia. He was Fern Gully. Was he right? Was he Fern Gully?
Yeah, he was.
Yeah, he was. So Anastasia, I mean, we saw how that turned out. Not so hot. Whereas, you know, Disney seemed to have perfected that. So was Oliver and Company a win? Arguably, no. I can't wait for us to re-rank this one because it might stay in the same space for me. But you know, that's only because I hate 101 Dalmatians so much.
It was, like, second last for you.
I don't remember. Okay. That's a fever dream too. I don't remember anything about where I put
think
this
it
movie.
Was second last for me, and that will depend on how bad Down Under is. I have no idea.
Yeah. And you know what? Like I said, I can't wait for us to revisit this one because I do think the soundtrack gets it a lot of credit. And it should. I think the soundtrack is really solid for a lot of these animal films. It is up there for me because they are objectively well-crafted songs. You know, you might not love them, but they're good pieces of music and they feel more culturally relevant than a lot of the other soundtracks you get that aren't as listenable. This one is very listenable because they worked with real, you know, popular music artists to make that come to life. So
for sure.
Good story. Meh. But music? Zesty.
Well, Kirbs, apology time, and I just really need to apologize for my mispronunciation of names all across the board on this episode. Special shout out to Scribner, who I was calling Shribner, and Jenny, who I called Penny. I still don't even know whose name is who.
In your defense for that one, originally it was going to be Penny.
I know.
As a sequel, but then they were like, better not. Oh, and we're like,
doesn't make sense. So
yeah, and we're like, tell us what else is new.
Yeah,
I mean, at least you're not out here making claims about where someone was born, which is what I did. I boldly was like, Scribner was from New York City. Awesome. And then I remember us, and the listeners will remember as well. You say to me, I don't think that's true. I'm like, I'm gonna keep going with that anyway. So apparently, he actually was born in Panama City. So Scribner, you're getting a lot of airtime on this episode. Mm-hmm. We talk about you quite a bit, so I really should be saying more accurate facts. Yeah. Well, that's true. We're saying your name wrong, and we're disrespecting your place of birth. So. Yeah. I feel like maybe we could give him his flowers some other time in a way that's maybe more appropriate than us getting everything wrong about him. So.
Yeah, maybe. We'll try it again another time.
Yeah, or not. And we'll just tell him we love him just the way he is. And he should accept us for who we are, too.
Yeah. Yeah, he should. And, of course, we've got some resources that we could have not done this without. I read a couple articles, one by the New York Times called Film Oliver and Company Gives Dickens a Disney Twist Urban Scene from an Appropriate Rooftop. That is a mouthful of a title, but it is by John Colhane. And then another biography piece on George Scribner, which was on breezewiki.com.
Wow. That first one, I'm still really reeling about how long of a mouthful that was.
I know. I wasn't ready for it going in, but
No. And I feel I'm still not ready now, but we're going to do our very best to just keep limping along. I also had to just outdo you a little bit by doubling up on the number of sources. Considering neither of us like this movie, I really had a lot of things to review. So... Mm-hmm. Here we go. The first was an article by someone named Doug Jameson, whose name we can pronounce off the hop, so that's kind of nice for him. He wrote an article for Film Motomy called 1988 in Film, Oliver and Company. And as if that wasn't interesting enough, I then wrote? I didn't write anything. I read a piece called Land Before Time and Oliver and Company Battle at the Box Office 30 years ago, and Disney lost. Mm. Hot take there in the title, by Brett White for Decider. Then I read an article called Once Upon a Time in New York City, Oliver and Company's director, George Scribner, with an exclamation point, by Jeremy Noyer for Animated Views. And then last but not least, an article called Things Only Adults Notice in Oliver and Company by Sam Scott for Looper. I need to point out that that article is really making it sound like he's calling out over the top, like, oh my gosh, I never noticed this as a kid. It's actually just things like, hey, the cars had license plates. You know, and I can't remember distinctly, what pieces from that article I used, but like, this is not one of like Kirbs is hot resources that you should definitely check out, which is not a catchy title, but it's not one you necessarily need to circle back to, but it's worth identifying.
Oh, well, we mentioned that fun fact alone.
Perfect.
And if you're looking for more shenanigans just like these, make sure you subscribe to the Scenario D podcast wherever you love to listen, and better yet, why not rate us? Because those stars, they really help us out. They go a long way.
They go a super long way. Almost as long away as Aisha's star goes in Wish. You know, all the way up there. Just trying to make this actual really relevant.
Not quite that far, but yes.
You don't think that far?
No.
How far will they go? Moana 2 far?
I see what you did there.
Sorry guys, today they announced like Moana 2, so we've been talking about it, so it's really on the brain. This is the worst outro we've ever done, so let's wrap it
possibly
up. All right, so we're also excited to be bringing you all the facts, feels, and shenanigans over on YouTube. You can now support us by liking, subscribing, ringing the notification bell, and doing everything else you'd normally do for a channel you love. So go ahead, watch our latest episode using the link in this episode's description.
And as always, do not forget to catch us on Instagram at Scenario D Podcast. You're going to love the magic we're making there.